Newspapers. This is 11, WTTW Chicago.
Why does man paint? What is it in patches of color burned on cave walls or outlined by frames that kindles our interest? To paint is to express the significant, hunted deer, the untouched god, nature. In a mountain's valley, man singles out himself as part of a greater whole. Reacting with his environment, he expresses emotion and intellect. In defining himself, the artist plays middleman. His work sets reality of the time and creates impact for later generations. A painting can be looked at anytime. It holds the path to escape, a freedom only the artist can place in visual realms. If music is the voice of the soul, then art is the vision of the spirit. Caveman sought the simplest reason for creativeness: natural forms meshed with artistic reality. Turning about, primitive man and all later artists discovered within painting a reality closer to truth than reality itself. Observe and participate in man's artistic development, we must see the real thing, the original object. Buildings have been set aside for this purpose. Museums filled with treasures of reality and fantasy. The city of Chicago has one of these treasure houses. The Art Institute of Chicago holds 250,000 objects worth over $500 million. It is impossible within this film to cover all of its artistic wealth. Instead, we focus here on those objects always on display, the Institute's permanent painting collection. The museum's 800,000 square feet, in addition to its galleries, contain the country's largest art school, the Goodman Theater, a movie house, and an extensive library. Two million visitors a year view its collections of Oriental, African, and primitive art, sculpture, American and European decorative arts, textiles, and paintings. The Art Institute is history. It is Chicago. Founded in 1879, it was supported by its leading citizens, Armour, Deering, McCormick, Hutchinson, Ryerson, and Palmer. Power, taste, and dedication supported the young museum. Hard work was necessary. Goals were set and achieved. Finding new patrons, gaining a Columbian Exposition building as a permanent home, catching the public's eye, and acquiring major works of art. Reflecting and encompassing these many attributes of the Art Institute, this film presents the museum's original and lasting claim to fame, the permanent collection of its drawings and paintings. A faceless 20th century woman to a tortured Christ hung from a 13th century cross. From these galleries, 700 years of Western culture look out at us. Richard the Lionhearted has just died, and the children's crusade is beginning. It is the time of St. Francis of Assisi and Dante. It is the time of Henry III and Chaucer, of Erasmus, St. Thomas More, and Machiavelli. It is also the time of the Hundred Years' War, the Battle of Agincourt, Joan of Arc's execution, and the plague of the Black Death. The major benefactor of art in these centuries is the church. Religious subject matter dominates the period. Medieval art serves emotional rather than intellectual needs. The Virgin Mary assumes enormous importance at this time. Paintings concentrate on the details of her life. The background is again gold, which places the Madonna in a timeless world of the past. Botticelli is one of the first artists during these centuries whose personality comes through the canvas. A strange, introspective man, he is motivated by a desire to purify Christianity. In this period, the artist sheds his role of craftsman and becomes specifically and self-consciously a creative genius. Outside of Italy, the artist remains often an anonymous figure. In Germany, medieval emotionalism lingers. The taste for extreme subjects dominates art. It is 1893. The year has begun with excitement and optimism for the United States. In Chicago, Illinois, the World's Columbian Exposition is open to celebrate the 400th anniversary of America's discovery. It is appropriate that the exposition site should be Chicago, a swampy village 60 years ago, now a city of 1.5 million people. The trustees of Chicago's Art Institute decide to make use of this holiday occasion. They cooperate with the managers of the World's Columbian Exposition in building a hall for the Congresses of Religion. It is agreed that at the end of the exposition, the building's ownership will revert to the Art Institute for its permanent use. The beginnings of the Institute go back to the Chicago Academy of Design, established by a group of post-Civil War artists. Stricken by mismanagement and then the Great Fire of 1871, the Academy of Design collapses. An effort to rescue the Academy, adding a board of business trustees to the artists' management, fails after a year. All resign. Immediately, plans are drawn to form a new organization.
Dear Sir, the undersigned, believing it to be desirable to organize at once in this city an institution for the encouragement of fine arts, hereby invite you to meet with them for that purpose on Thursday evening, May 15th, 1879, at 8 o'clock at the Palmer House.
Months of planning result in a new organization, the Chicago Academy of Fine Arts. Its goals are defined in the license of incorporation.
Not the aesthetic gratification of a few lovers of art only is concerned in this undertaking, but it is the desire and expectation to interest the public generally and to produce results so practical and appealing so strongly to the taste, the pride, and the enlightened foresight of our citizens as to merit and receive their prompt and substantial support.
The new academy rents rooms, art classes begin. Occasional exhibitions are shown. Then the Academy changes its name and moves to a new home.
A certificate of incorporation was issued by the Secretary of State of Illinois, under which the Chicago Academy of Fine Arts was established on a permanent basis for the purpose of maintaining a museum. On December 21st, 1882, by due legal process, the name of the corporation is changed to that of the Art Institute of Chicago.
Outgrowing two buildings in the next 10 years, the flourishing Art Institute makes its agreement with the World's Columbian Exposition. 1893, which began with hope, ends with an economic depression. The great white city of the Columbian Exposition closes. The Art Institute moves into its newly acquired building.
One of the finest structures of its kind in the world, and unquestionably the best suited for its purpose in the United States. It will stand both as monument of what has been accomplished and a prophecy of the position art will yet hold in this empire of the West.
During the next years of its growth and expansion, the Art Institute is under the guidance and control of Charles L. Hutchinson. There are more than 70 organizations in which he is a contributing member. He is a trustee of Presbyterian Hospital and the University of Chicago. He is the treasurer of the Civic Opera Company and the Immigrants Protective League. He is the vice president of the Egyptian Exploration Fund and the Illinois Merchants Trust Company. He is the president of the Orphan Asylum, the Corn Exchange Bank, and the Art Institute of Chicago. He is a man of strength, conviction, and taste. In 1906, a painting is purchased. Charles L. Hutchinson is instrumental in its acquisition. The story of the purchase begins in Spain. While traveling with friends, the American artist Mary Cassatt discovers a major painting by El Greco. In her attempt to find an American buyer for it, she writes the Chicago Art Institute. Some months later, Miss Cassatt writes a friend about this correspondence.
Perhaps my receiving the Legion of Honor will get me a little influence with the museum directors at home. I do so much want to get them to acquire genuine old masters, such as the El Greco Assumption. I have had a letter from the president of the Art Institute in Chicago, and I have some hopes there.
The painting is ordered on approval and is shipped to Chicago. On arrival, newspaper articles discussing the painting's acquisition raise a storm of protest.
The Art Institute, following the present European fad for minor artists, has just ordered a painting by the second or perhaps third-rate artist commonly known as El Greco. The composition indicates clearly the beginnings of decadence in art.
The Art Institute's director, William French, is caught in a dilemma. Should he make the purchase, which will almost swamp his treasury, or should he risk not buying it and lose one of the world's great art treasures?
I do not remember ever to have seen an El Greco in European art galleries. One of his paintings recently brought $37,000 in New York. The Assumption is one of his best works, and it would be a valuable addition to the Institute. But I cannot say I am ready to pay $40,000 for it.
In Europe at this time, the Institute's president, Charles Hutchinson, writes to Mr. French.
Ryerson and I ran down to Madrid. We saw no picture by El Greco better than his Assumption. It seems to me ours in Chicago is a really great picture. I'm anxious to see it again.
The history of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary begins at the time when the Greek painter called El Greco goes to Spain, called there by command of King Philip II. The Assumption is one of 9 canvases executed by El Greco as altar ornaments for the Cathedral of Santo Domingo el Antiqua in Toledo. The canvas is completed in 1577. 200 years later, the painting is purchased by the son-in-law of the King of Portugal, Infante Don Sebastian de Bourbon. The painting's last purchase is now, in 1906. The Art Institute of Chicago holds a director's meeting. Mr. Hutchinson's enthusiasm for the El Greco prevails. The trustees vote to buy what becomes the greatest object of the Art Institute's permanent collection. Holland is the intellectual capital of the world, and England is in civil war. It is the time of Cromwell and Molière and the Salem witch trials. In France, Louis XIV is king. In England, William and Mary reign, and then the House of Hanover. In North America, Franklin and Washington will soon be born. In the old world, Bach and Handel will die. It is the time of Valley Forge and the Bastille, of Mozart and Haydn. It is the age of reason and of Voltaire and of Napoleon. No longer is any single group considered the major patron of art. The nobility and the church still wield vast power. Prosperity is on the rise. A middle class is formed, which soon becomes a major social force. Peter Paul Rubens continues the emotionally charged attitude toward religion evident in the work of El Greco. His dramatic presentations aim to overwhelm the senses. No longer, however, is there the shrouded mystery of medieval art. Here, triumph and light glorify the senses. In Rome, once again an important artistic center, the work of Michelangelo Caravaggio introduces a whole generation of artists to a new formula. Intensity of emotion remains high, but a new realism is felt, characterized by the use of peasant types to represent biblical characters. Although shocking to many of his contemporaries, Caravaggio's innovation spread throughout Europe. As this style gains popularity, the intensity of the religious experience often becomes diluted in favor of an emphasis on realism. In France, Romantic classicism becomes a major source for Rococo painting. Painted by François Boucher, the subject matter is anything but intellectual. Sweet, erotic, and suggestive, it is an aristocratic society's image of the pastoral ideal. Giovanni Domenico Tiepolo's illustrations for Tasso's Jerusalem Delivered are painted at the same time as the Boucher. The source for these paintings is a romantic epic dealing with the First Crusade. Although the poem contains a complex plot, Tiepolo chooses to emphasize its pastoral lyricism, The colors are soft and the landscape decorative. Northern, mostly Protestant Europe, meanwhile, develops a vigorous art as an alternative to this pastoral tradition. In Holland, this movement is most noticeable. Expanding in a bourgeois democracy, Dutch painting represents the material well-being of its people. New types of painting representing the matter of fact flourish in this commercial environment. Painted with attention to texture, color, and form, they emphasize a sense of prosperity. The Dutch raise their common lives to an established art form. Thank you. A Russian nobleman, Prince Demidov, originally owned this portrait of a girl by Rembrandt. The prince turned his Florentine palace into a treasure house of art. Anatole Demidov willed the masterpieces to his nephew, who proceeded to build up what was generally conceded to be the finest private collection in the world. But when Prince Demidov dies in the late 1880s, his heirs find themselves forced to sell the fabulous collection. As it happens, three Chicagoans, Charles L. Hutchinson, William French, and Martin Ryerson, are in France at the time. Hearing that the famous collection is to be broken up, they rush to the prince's home near Florence and without hesitation advance $206,000 for 13 masterpieces. They know that when the Art Institute will be in a position financially to acquire such paintings, the opportunity for buying them will have been forever lost. Reaction in America to the purchase is divided. The New York press.
They probably paid $1,000 a front foot for the paintings. And we presume the citizens of Chicago will give them a triumphal procession along the lakefront. They should be carried on huge floats drawn by teams of milk-white hogs that have been newly washed.
In Chicago, the response is more pleasant.
The acquisition of these pictures has done more toward drawing the attention of the art world to Chicago than everything else combined. In a word, they have made Chicago and the Art Institute famous.
The most celebrated of the Dutch masters is Rembrandt van Rijn. Although his paintings are known throughout the world, his most intimate expression is to be found in his drawings. It is in them that we are allowed some insight into his working methods. Rembrandt never tires of observing simple people or telling biblical stories. Noah's Ark is a drawing from the last 10 years of his life. In this late period, he prefers the broad, incisive strokes of a reed pen to the more flexible quill pen. The story is pared down to its essentials. The only animal is a dog who is part of the humble family moving toward the Ark. Here, Rembrandt again strives to illuminate the essence of the story in its simplest and truest human terms. This work is part of the large and extensive holdings in the Art Institute of Chicago's print and drawing collection. This department collects, preserves, and exhibits works of art on paper. Drawing stands at the beginning of almost every artistic activity. Many artists file away figure or landscape studies until there is occasion for their use in painting. Others feel a need for putting down on paper an overflowing wealth of ideas when there is neither time nor opportunity to work them out in a more time-consuming medium. Many times a drawing is a rough sketch, a shorthand notation rather than a finished product. Drawing, therefore, allows the viewer to participate in the artist's creative impulse and his groping for realization of a project. One of the most sensitive and gracious draftsmen is Antoine Watteau. He is born in 1684. This decade produces a generation richer than any other in great musicians. Rameau was born the year before, Scarlatti, Handel, and Bach a year later. It is therefore not surprising that music, the dance, and the theater are the lifeblood of Watteau's art. His work and all 18th century French drawing is in great demand. It reflects aristocratic elegance and splendor. It is the art of chateaus and palaces, of marquises and dukes. Daumier concerns himself almost exclusively with the human condition. His profound insight into human nature raises his work to a high level. This court scene is one of his most serious works. Three judges deliberate the evidence of a murder trial. In the characterization of the three judges, there is a wealth of subtle diversification that could give enough material for a whole novel. In America, several artists are working on paper. The Philadelphian Thomas Akins is one. In this watercolor, he shows his two friends, the painter William Sartain, listening to Max Schmidt playing the zither. It is one of Akin's highest achievements in intimate portraiture. Rarely has the action of hands making music been rendered with such sensitive understanding. Winslow Homer is one of the most influential of American painters. He is originally a newspaper illustrator. Following the Civil War, Homer devotes himself to painting. Later, he, more than any other American artist, makes watercolor his medium. And it is as a watercolorist that he is at his best. He manages to avoid the petty and trivial and does not fall into the trap of adapting oil painting techniques to watercolor. In his later life, Homer moves to Maine. There, in isolation, he paints almost exclusively the coast near his home and the raging Atlantic Ocean. Other American artists feel it necessary to travel to Europe to study and to paint. Mary Cassatt is born in Pennsylvania, but chooses to live in Paris. There she meets Degas and profits from his friendship, advice, and example. She is a strong, independent woman who never marries. It is the time of railroad transportation and gas lighting. Chopin and Liszt dazzle audiences. People are reading Stendhal and Balzac. In America, Lincoln is president, and the Confederacy loses its war at Gettysburg. Victoria is in the middle of her reign, and the Commune rules Paris. Artists begin to paint for themselves, for their own satisfaction. Tubes of paint, a recent invention, allow the artist to move freely out of doors. Paris is the art center of Europe. Its art establishment is powerful and conservative. Young artists find the times difficult. Alternatives to academic and romantic painting are not tolerated. To survive, many artists leave Paris. Camille Corot is one of them. His view of Genoa lucidly evokes the beauties of a Mediterranean summer's day. Jean-François Millet, like Corot and others, settles in the rural village of Barbizon near the forests of Fontainebleau. Millet and the Barbizon school paint outdoors. Their scenes of country life are sometimes rude, usually direct, often sentimental. These artists prepare the way for Monet, Degas, and Renoir. In Holland, a Dutch painter working essentially alone captures a sense of light and atmosphere. Johan Bartolt Jonkin's undramatic and non-picturesque landscapes go unnoticed by the critics and the public. Jonkin, working for himself, perseveres. Claude Monet, dissatisfied with Parisian studio teaching, is drawn to Jonkin and Millet and the painters in Barbizon. His technique is to quickly describe a scene with loose, broad brushstrokes. Composition is casual, subject matter irrelevant. Monet and his colleagues are labeled as impressionists. They develop a style designed to push painting to its limits in depicting the optical realities of atmospheric light. Monet, to achieve this end, uses pure, unmixed colors. Applied directly onto the canvas, they create the sparkle and luminosity of light. Dots, slashes, and patches of color create a vibrancy by their interaction. He is obsessed by the effects of light at different times of day and seasons. Monet paints quickly. he attempts to capture the unique qualities of a moment. Not all the Impressionists are concerned with the out-of-doors. Mary Cassatt's close friend and colleague, Edgar Degas, has a strong sense of form, which he allies with an Impressionist's sense of color. He becomes increasingly interested in Japanese prints. This affects his point of view and style of composition. Degas is an urban painter, interested in psychological relationships. He becomes the greatest portraitist of the group. In Uncle and Niece, he portrays his bachelor uncle, Henri Degas, and his orphan niece, Lucy, with insight and tenderness. Degas' eyesight fails later in his life. He dies a blind man. After early experiences with Monet and Fontainebleau, Pierre-Auguste Renoir strays from pure out-of-doors painting. In his early Impressionist work, Renoir concentrates on intimate and cheerful scenes. They have the radiance and glow of a summer's day. His sketchy brushwork dissolves his subject in a wash of brilliant colors. Renoir adores the south of France. Afflicted by arthritis, he moves into a Riviera villa surrounded by olive trees planted at the time of William the Conqueror. A devoted husband, the father of three adored sons, Renoir has a lifelong infatuation with women and children of beauty.
Thank you.
Paris remains the art capital of Europe and continues to be the subject for most impressionists. A civil engineer by profession, Gustave Caillebotte is well-to-do. He buys many works of his impressionist friends. On his early death, he bequeathed this large collection to the state. Unfortunately for the Louvre, however, only a small portion of the paintings are deemed acceptable for showing. He paints himself when time permits. The Place de l'Europe is Caillebotte's finest work. It is constructed with the skill evident in his engineering. Surprisingly, this large canvas is painted 7 years before Seurat begins work on the Grand Jatte. The Impressionist movement is relatively short-lived. Degas and Renoir express dissatisfaction with its techniques. Young artists begin to rally around a new leader, Georges Seurat. Their approach is more scientific. Seurat uses brushstrokes in dot form. Sunday afternoon on the island of La Grande Jatte is Seurat's masterpiece. This huge canvas takes Seurat 2 years to complete. It is first shown in May 1886 at the Salon des Indépendants. There it causes great controversy. The critic Félix Fignon describes the artist's technique.
It is 4 o'clock on Sunday afternoon in the dog days. On the river, the swift barks dart to and fro. On the island itself, the Sunday population has come together at random among the trees to delight in the fresh air. Seurat has created his 40 or so figures in summary in hieratic style, setting them up frontally or with their back to us or in profile, seated at right angles, stretched out horizontally, or bolt upright.
Frederick Clay Bartlett, the artist, and Helen Birch Bartlett, poet and composer, buy Seurat's Grand Jatte for $24,000. From this purchase, they build up a collection of post-impressionist works, which is given to the Institute. Newspapers label the acquisitions as progressive.
Surely it is significant that at the very time when the academic critics of New York are congratulating themselves and the public on what they describe as the return to sanity and beauty in painting and sculpture, Chicago should have decided that the wild men are as important as the old masters.
Bartletts are not alone in their donation. Bequests to the Art Institute of large and comprehensive painting collections is the rule rather than the exception. These princely gifts are donated by Chicago's first generation of collectors and their descendants. During these middle years of the Art Institute, one name stands out in its close association with Chicago and its museum, Mrs. Potter Palmer. She is a leader in women's rights and urges her sex to command notice.
Dear Miss Cassatt, I know your hatred of art jury service. It nevertheless is a great point gained by women to have their names prominently mentioned on art juries. It will help your sex, who are generally entirely unrecognized in art matters. Pray do not refuse.
Mary Cassatt refuses jury service, but does lead the Palmers to Durand Ruel's Paris Gallery, home ground for the Impressionists.
Dear sir, I write to ask for the dates of all the picture sales in Paris during May, as Mr. Palmer and I expect a sale on the 7th of April and will be in Europe during May. I am with kindest regards, very truly yours, Mrs. Potter Palmer.
By the time her buying spree is over, Mrs. Palmer has bought 32 Monets, 4 Sisleys, 6 Pissarros, 4 Renoirs. Most of these she turns over to the Art Institute's painting collection. Art patrons to follow Mrs. Palmer no longer concentrate, however, on the Impressionists. Like Degas in his later works, these new patrons turn their interest to the more calculated approach of the post-impressionists. Most of the immediate post-impressionists begin by painting in the impressionist style. Paul Cézanne pinpoints problems of the successors to impressionism when he says that he wants to make of Impressionism something solid and durable, like the art of museums. Cézanne utilizes the freshness and purity of Impressionist color, but uses color gradations to create form rather than to dissolve it. The Gulf of Marseille, seen from Lestock, is formalized and highly structured. Cézanne tries to capture the permanent and not the fleeting moment of a Monet landscape. Characteristic of post-Impressionist art is its diversity. Painters face similar problems but find different solutions. One unifying tendency is a lack of common stylistic bonds. They enormously widen the range of possibilities in art. Pictorially, art describes more than it ever has before, even if its reality is only in the mind of the artist. Parisian lowlife is documented by Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec. The Moulin Rouge is the most popular dance hall in Paris during this period. Toulouse-Lautrec shifts the interest from the dance floor to the audience. He depicts a mixture of intellectuals, friends, and dancers. The color scheme is based on the artificial light of Paris nightlife. Like Degas, Toulouse-Lautrec owes much to the example set by Japanese printmakers. Common to the post-impressionist movement, his artistic training is unorthodox. Largely self-taught, Lautrec's development is based on a strong personal feeling about art. During the 2 years he lives in Paris, the Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh is influenced by Seurat. Van Gogh is fascinated by the research, which is the scientific basis for optical experiments. He attempts to adapt Pointillist theories to his own work. Characteristically, this man of unruly temperament and impatience uses loose, long strokes instead of dots. The effect, rather than Seurat's coolness and objectivity, is one of emotion. In the span of a very few years, Van Gogh is tremendously productive. He paints 24 self-portraits in 2 years. Filled with ideas, he does not have time to produce them all. No occasion for serene renewal is possible within his troubled mind. Heightened colors, twisting forms, his deranged mental condition flows out onto the canvas. His mind becomes unmanageable. Van Gogh is placed in an asylum. His vast amount of work represents the life of the mind and the world about him. He ranks with the other great Dutch painters not only for his human appeal, but for his technical accomplishments as an artist. Paul Gauguin begins as an amateur painter. He is self-taught. He paints at first in the manner of the Impressionists with whom he exhibits. Eventually, Gauguin turns to painting professionally. After an unsuccessful and stormy attempt to work with Van Gogh, Gauguin travels to the islands of the South Seas. Here he finds the emotionalism and expressiveness of primitive culture an invigorating tonic to the convention of establishment art. The Wright brothers have flown the first airplane, Edison is at Menlo Park, and Dreyfus is on Devil's Island. It is the time of Stravinsky and Schoenberg, of the horseless buggy and the telephone. It is the time of Montenegro, Serbia, and the Archduke Ferdinand. It is the time of Swanson and Chaplin, of Lindbergh and Ruth. There are good times and there are hard times. It is the time of the Zeppelin and the Flying Fortress. Battles are fought at Guadalcanal and Stalingrad. Two bombs are dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. It is the time of the Marshall Plan, the Iron Curtain, the UN, and ecology. It is now. Artists remain close to nature through the 20th century, but the different isms of modern art place this relationship in the abstract. Cubism is the first new approach to the consideration of nature in art since the Renaissance perspective. Instead of regarding it from a fixed point, nature is examined from multiple views. It is transformed from a natural object into a pictorial object. As the cubists view nature in abstract terms, the expressionists abandon all representational forms. The movement develops in Germany and concentrates on emotional use of line and color. Kandinsky is master of this movement. He is born in Moscow. Giving up his legal studies, Kandinsky begins to paint and study in Munich. In his theory of color, he sees yellow as terrestrial, blue as celestial, white as a vast silence full of possibility, and black as an emptiness devoid of all possibility. Other artists seek the fantastic and irrational. Influenced by dreams and psychology, they earn the name of surrealist. These artists define their goal as expressions of the true process of thought, free from the exercise of reason and from any aesthetic or moral purpose. The artist's dream flows from the unconscious mind to the canvas. The International Center for Contemporary Art after World War II is America. Artistic movements vary greatly, from Edward Hopper's The Nighthawks with its spellbinding mood to formless patches of color and line. The stylistic school of abstract expressionism is generally non-objective and highly emotional. There is no trace of recognizable forms in the works of Pollock, Rothko, and de Kooning. They paint their minds and the surrounding world as they perceive it. Dots used for printing comic strip colors on cheap paper make their way to large canvases in the 1960s. Lichtenstein sets the pace with his blown-up single frame of the comic strip technique. Colored dots blend optically at a distance. Some artists turn again toward representational forms. Richard Estes examines photographic realism. His precise rendering of objects seems to be the end product of shutter and lens rather than paintbrush. This technique conveys a mood as definite as the emotional charge of expressionism, the fantasy of surrealism, or the systematic analysis of cubism. Why does man paint? Perhaps the answer is discernible in the paintings we have just looked at. They and many others make up the permanent painting collection of the Art Institute of Chicago. Blank 20th century faces to tortured 13th century Christs shine out at us. These paintings illuminate the paths and tracks that have led us through history to this place and this time. The paintings in these corridors and galleries represent the best of us. They record the best of times. Through paintings, we find a reality about ourselves that is closer to truth than reality itself.
Thank you.
Tonight on The Dick Cavett Show, John Kenneth Galbraith, Edwin Newman, Agnes DeMille, and John Simon debate, Is English a Dying Language? Join us tonight at 10. This fall, the world of ideas, the inside story, the unexpected, on John Calloway Interviews, Mondays and Wednesdays at 7.
Good evening. I'm Ed Murrow. The name of the program is Person to Person.
The World as It Was, Person to Person, Mondays at 7:30, starting October 2nd.
Oh, Francie, if you want to go to bed with her, then do so. But you'll marry Helena.
Fall of Eagles, the passion, greed, and power of three great European dynasties.
Should be interested only in Austria, the Empire, and the continuation of the Habsburg line. That should be your passion, your sole purpose for living.
The clash of three royal families as they struggle to control Europe, their lust for power.
The king has offered me the throne.
Their political intrigues.
I often forget, Your Highness, but I never forgive.
Fall of Eagles, a stunning new dramatic series, Mondays at 8, starting October 2nd. At 7, John Calloway Interviews. At 7:30, Person to Person. At 8, Fall of Eagles, Mondays starting October 2nd. Today on Channel 11, public television for Chicago is made possible in part by a grant from the Lerner Newspapers. This is 11, WTTW Chicago.